Are you ready to play a game?
Finally.
I just watched episode 4 of Squid Game, so I'm actually not ready to play a game, yeah. But let's do it anyways.
All right, this game is called Whodunnit. Oh, we give you a quote. You guys come together in a minute and tell us whodunnit.
It's concerning.
First quote. Everybody kind of likes watching me play, whether they're cheering for me out of sarcasm or actual fandom or whatever. I would like it to be a little bit more warranted with some success in winning. And your choices are A, Hunter Renfro, B, Alex Caruso, C, Braxton Berrios, or D, Max McClung.
Oh my gosh. You're coming up with a multiple choice. Why are we crossing out Braxton Berrios? He's not funny?
Because Braxton Berrios is an army of simps, right? Like, come on. I can imagine reasons for the other three.
So, like, who wants to be in a millionaire style? A and B are the only viable options here. Hunter Renfro and Alex Caruso, because they're the only ones, I think, with, like, fan bases. I think the question is who's more self-aware.
Yeah. Hunter Renfro, though, like, it's such a non-football thing. Like, when do you ever really cheer for football players? Like, it doesn't really happen. You cheer or boo for quarterbacks, and that's about it. Unless Hunter's walking through the mall and people are just like mockingly cheering for him and he appreciates it or something. I don't know. I think
it's Caruso because Caruso fears that's happening to him while also getting it a lot more often. So I think democratically.
It's easy.
Caruso like trends and people call him the bald eagle and stuff. It's got to be Caruso.
Yes. Great nickname.
That is beautiful.
All right, Alabaster.
You get it?
Final answer.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh.
Are we supposed to read that or is Alabaster supposed to read it?
No.
I think you get to say it. So Alex Caruso is fully self-aware that some of his fandom is ironic. I wanna push back on that. I don't think that it's sarcasm. Like, I think it's similar to the Hunter Renfro dynamic where there's like a little bit of delight in seeing someone who doesn't look like who defies expectations. Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you mean.
Yeah, I'm confused.
What do you mean?
You gotta elaborate. Be more specific.
Oh, look, here's a quote from Alex Caruso. I think he is saying what I intended to say.
Come on.
The fact I look like I could be a common person walking on the street, they all want to hold on to, like, hey, that's one of us out there doing it. Okay, I'm gonna finish what I was saying.
Yeah, I'm looking this
up. He's not that tall, dude. And that's the thing about him and Renfro. It's not just the fact that they have a skin tone similar to Alabaster, our friend. It's the fact that they both look like dudes who could work in IT.
Yeah.
But here's the thing, Mina. Here's the thing. Because I, you're right. You've diagnosed why people feel this way and why you may even feel this way. But I just Googled Alex Caruso. And Alex Caruso is 6'4".
Yeah.
And I know that's not the tallest NBA player, but like, we're not Alex Caruso.
You don't walk past 6'4" people all the time.
Let me make a comp here. This didn't happen with, say, J.J. Redick, who looks like a star when you see him.
He looks like a villain in a teen movie.
No, it's because J.J. Redick does the things that you would expect of a person who looks like that. The same as Hunter Renfro. Like, Hunter Renfro is a tiny white slot receiver. We are completely comfortable with tiny white slot receiver.
Receding hair.
Yeah, I'm sorry to break this to you. Receding hairline, white guards who are out here catching alleys off the rim, like, that is so uncommon.
Let's just also be more specific about this. I think the real demographic sort of characteristic about Alex Caruso that makes everybody feel this way is that he is, in fact, like, dealing with male pattern baldness. Like, there's a relatability to a guy who's just like,
I think it dealt with him, honestly.
I'm not trying to make a cross-racial comp to a classic cross-racial comp. No, I think it's the same reason why people love Bartolo Colon is the fact that he doesn't look like he should be good at what he does, right? Or didn't look like. And like the man had two families and no one cares because of how he looks.
Very true. No, allegedly Bartolo Colon definitely has allegedly had two families.
Sorry, allegedly two families.
Because he allegedly looks like, grimace. We allegedly ignore that.
I feel like a lot of white men feel about Alex Caruso the way I felt about all black quarterbacks up until like the last 5 years. All of them were the greatest.
When did that flip? Yes. What was the point when you became a post-racial NFL analyst?
I'm not quite there yet. I'm trying. I'm fighting. But it takes a good amount for me to be critical of a black quarterback because it feels like everyone else is just waiting to pounce on him. But I'm getting to the point where I can fairly view all of these quarterbacks in the league now. I think I got there. It was when the undefeated determined the year of the black quarterback. I think it was the season that Lamar Jackson won the MVP. And then I was like, all right, whew. Then we looked around the league. It is like 8 or 10 starting black quarterbacks. Geno Smith has a backup job. That's the real truth about the future of post-racial NFL quarterback play. Is when the black quarterbacks can be the homie that gets a check for being the homie. Like, that doesn't happen.
When we don't even mention, we've gone however long we've been doing this fake TV show now, we haven't even mentioned that Geno Smith got punched in the face by his own teammate. That is progress.
Is it?
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.